Good morning. If I can get the technical team's attention for a moment, I just noticed that these lights are out. Is that okay? I didn't let there be light, I believe was the appropriate, you know what they say, timing. It's great to be with all of you on this beautiful day, and wonderful to have a special guest in our choir this morning, Kristen Hockenstedt Koss, who people might not know was a elder on the session of this church when she was 16, I think. Yeah, she was 16 years old. And also, I just want to, what'd you say? A year or two ago. Exactly. I also just want to appreciate Allison did has added two candles to the chancel in blue and gold, blue and yellow. So as a lighted keeping in our hearts the people of Ukraine. The people of every country on every side of every conflict who are caught up and suffering in war. So with that, welcome. And if anyone would like to introduce themselves, if you know, to make sure you've got that Cheers experience where everyone knows your name, feel free if you want to say hello, or if you haven't been here for a while and you want to say I'm back. I'll give you a moment here, and I don't know if there's anyone on Zoom who might. I'll just keep an ear out, keep my eyes out. All right. Well, then, let us greet each other with a sign of peace, the peace that reminds us that we are sisters and brothers to each other in one holy family, without conflict, without need, built on love and sustained by compassion. May the peace of God be with you. Feel free to pass that peace any way you find.
Good morning and welcome everyone.
Good morning. I want to read something to you that is supposedly an ancient Sanskrit poem. I said that right. Look to this day, For yesterday is but a memory, and tomorrow is only a vision. But today, well lived, makes every yesterday a memory of happiness, and every tomorrow a vision of hope. Look well, therefore, to this day. Thank you. And I have one other thing to add. Go Tar Heels.
Please rise as we sing hymn 314.
The reading this morning is from Isaiah, chapter 43, verses 15 through 21. I am the Lord, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down. They cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches, for I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise.
Thank you, Kathy. Aw. Announcing a miracle here. Someone left Whopper. Will you please join me in a prayer for illumination? Beloved God, we give thanks for this day. We give thanks for the feel of the warm sun on our face, for the vision of the water and the hills, for the warmth that fills our heart from seeing the faces of others. And we give thanks for this time and this place that we can come here, that we can leave the week past in the past, and that we can leave the week to come in the future. And that in this time, as we gather, we can just be here now. So we pray, help us to enter into this time, to know that you're always with us, but now, this moment, this hour, we're all coming together to help lift each other into your presence. So we pray, soften our hearts and open our minds, that we might hear your word, and that the words spoken become the words each one of us needs to hear for where we are in our life today. We pray these things in your holy name. Amen. So there's something odd about today's reading, something odd about what God says here to the people of Israel. And this is a toughie. This isn't like, what's the greatest commandment sort of question, which can also be a toughie to answer. But there is something odd here, and I don't know if anybody heard something that sounded odd to them. Anybody want to take a crack at it from the reading? Something that stood out? Well, go, Fred.
After all the preamble there, the last sentence is, I created you for the praise.
Okay.
That seems...
Yeah, the animals. And you will your praise. Yes, good question. Not an uncommon, thing. And an interesting question.
We have a God complex.
Yes. Well, it is a really good question. I'll tell you the thing that is different, how is this verse different from all other verses on this night? What's different is that in the middle of this, God says, do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. Do not remember. Now, if you're like me, I need no encouragement to not remember the former things. I'm surprised by how many current things I do not remember. And I don't know if that makes me more righteous or not, but I think I'll think that from now on. But for God to tell the people of Israel, do not remember, is pretty amazing, because remembering is a core part of Judaism. In fact, God often says, remember. God often is telling us, remember. Remember the Sabbath day. Keep it holy. Twice in Deuteronomy, God commands that foreigners should be treated with generous hospitality by explaining, remember that you were a slave in Egypt and the Lord your God redeemed you from there. This is also true when a slave has served 6 years. They are to be set free. And when that slave is set free, they should be given food and many goods to prepare them for their new life. And again, God says, remember, you once were enslaved. In Exodus, when Moses encounters God for the first time at the burning bush, God says, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And remembering those forebears can be heard to this day in almost any synagogue on a Friday night Sabbath prayer. Often also remembering that God is the God of Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. And in the Christian Testament in Matthew, Jesus says, as for the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what it was said to you by God? I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. And in a couple weeks, the beginning of Passover will be celebrated with a Seder, a ritual meal whose primary objective is to remember. remember that you were slaves in Egypt. In fact, one should not just remember, but one should feel enslavement. As the Religious Action Center for Reformed Judaism put it in their Seder instructions, we must feel the lash and feel the hope that defeats the pain. We must feel the water at our feet and the fresh breeze of freedom on our face. Remembering is a big deal. So why on earth or in heaven above would God say, do not remember the former things or consider things of old? I'm sure you've heard the one about the guy in New York City who stopped someone on the street for directions and says, how can I get to Carnegie Hall? And the answer is, practice, practice, practice. Well, how do I get to the meaning of this ancient book? Context, context, context. That doesn't have the same punch as the practice, practice, but I'm working on it. And it is true. It's in the context. And this is what the context is for this. About 2,600 years ago, from this day exactly, Babylon, I'm making that part up, Babylon conquered Israel, the kingdom of Judah to be precise, destroyed the temple in Jerusalem, and marched the Jews to captivity in Babylonia. This is when the middle section of Isaiah was written. The book of Jeremiah recounts how God told the captive Jewish community to settle in and to make a home in Babylon, to plant trees, to marry Babylonians. And people did just that. And then about 75 years later, King Cyrus the Great of Persia conquered Babylon. And Cyrus said to the Jews, hey, you can go back home now. And I'm going to make sure you even have the resources you need to rebuild your temple. This was a miracle. In fact, Isaiah calls Cyrus God's anointed one, or the Messiah. This was great news. After suffering defeat by the Babylonians, the Jewish people got to see Babylonians get their comeuppance. And now, after being held in captivity and being away from home, the people were allowed to go back, to return, to come home. But, as Thomas Wolfe said, you can't go home again. Or at least, you can't always go back easily. You see, 75 years is a very long time in antiquity. Feels like a long time to me, too. But back then, it was especially a long time. Generations had come and gone. A lot of people didn't remember Israel. I mean, they had heard about it, of course, and they continued their prayers, but many had never been to Israel in their whole lives. They had grown up in Babylon. They knew Babylon. Babylon was home. And so many people asked themselves, should I stay or should I go? My great-grandmother came to this country from Ireland in the mid-1800s. She was 16 years old. She came with two older sisters, and she had no idea how far she was going. At some point during that long sail, she realized she would never see her mother again. My grandmother told me this. My grandmother told me how her mother cried herself to sleep every night for 3 years, how painfully she missed her mother, how much she missed Ireland. My grandmother told me this 100 years after my great-grandmother had set sail, and she told it with such passion. She felt her mother's anguish so deeply. Her mother had told her this story so often and so thoroughly that when my grandmother told me, I thought it was her story. And while we felt that pain, while she felt that pain so acutely, and while it meant the world to my grandmother to visit Ireland when she was in her 70s, my grandmother never would have wanted to move there. She would never have wanted to leave St. Louis, Missouri. That was her home. She was proud of it. It's where she had her children. It's where she was born. So I get it. I get that a bunch in the Jewish community loved to remember Israel, but they didn't want to leave Babylon. This is our home now. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. We're introducing a new thing. It's like a travel ad. That's what it is. I mean, to be a little flip, it's something they might have read in the Babylon Times. Don't settle for that old thing. We've got a new thing. More seriously, though, to quote the Reverend John Black, whose ideas have taught me a lot about this passage, he says, no, do not remember if remembering becomes a weight that holds you in place or causes you to cling to practices that enslave you or establishes a self-understanding that blocks the ability to see what God is doing right now in your midst. I've often spoken of tradition as an anchor because it can ground you. It can help you hold on to what's important, keep you rooted in the terra firma. But it can also bind you as any chain can. It can keep you back, keep you from moving forward. Every church has at least one chain holding it back, maybe two, maybe 17. No, we can't move that picture on the wall that was put there by a really dear parishioner 80 years ago. No, none of us ever knew him, but it's always been there. Sometimes we have a tradition or custom that remains solely because it's been stuck in the same place so long, it's just too hard to budge. I don't know how many folks remember that when I came here, I had suggested that we move the service from 9:30 to 10. And people said to me, there's a reason we have it at 9:30. Now there were preferences for 9:30, but people remembered there was some reason it is at 9:30. And it was a couple weeks before someone called me up, suddenly remembered, oh yeah, it's so we will be able to be out of the Altamira parking lot in time for the brunch rush. Now, for some of you, if you don't know, the Altamira went from being a restaurant to a rehab facility about at least 15 years ago. The brunch rush was a former thing, a thing of old. And the meaning of the former thing had been forgotten. It was just an anchor with no purpose. And it almost kept us from the new thing. I want to distinguish, not that I'm trying to improve on Isaiah, for heaven's sake, but I want to distinguish between remembering and clinging. I think we're talking about clinging. At least for me, that word conveys more of the fear and the desperation that can sometimes go into holding on to the past. My mom was a feminist before there was the National Organization of Women. My mom advocated vociferously for inclusion, full inclusion of the LGBTQ community in the Presbyterian Church. My mom could not bear the gender-neutral doxology. For those of you who might not know what I'm talking about, there's a short hymn often sung at the offering. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Traditionally, praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Depending where you go, you might hear, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God all creatures here below. Praise God above ye heavenly host. Creator, Son, Creator Christ and Holy Ghost. So my mom refused to make that change. She refused the new thing. And, you know, she would sing extra loud, which was an impressive thing, believe you me. The former words, you know, we're all standing up and it seems like a peaceful moment. And all of a sudden she's like belting out, you know, everyone else. But no doubt it's the intractable appeal. The intractable appeal for her was the strong sense of familiarity, of home, of comfort, that made it hard for her to let go. Sometimes we have an idea about ourselves from the past. Sometimes we have an old thing about who we are. And it could be a good, a real good thing, or it could be a bad, a real bad thing. But we have an idea about ourselves, and we might even have forgotten where that idea came from. It's just always been there. It's just the way I am. Perhaps it's been there so long, we forgot that it's not actually part of our DNA. Sometimes we have an idea about church and how things should be done and why we do things and who should be doing what. And oh no, we can't possibly change the color of the nursery. It's been that way forever. And by forever, I mean, that's the way it was when I got here. And everyone told me it couldn't be changed. Only God is unchanging. And you can find theology that suggests that's up for debate as well. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I'm about to do a new thing. How do we come to that new thing with the blessings of the past, but not being held back by it? We do need to remember. It's important to remember. It's important to honor traditions. Those who don't remember the past are doomed to repeat it. Sometimes we throw out a valuable tradition just because it's a tradition, just because it's old, feels a little creaky, just because something new and shiny has come along and it looks better, it feels better, sexier. Sometimes we throw out parts of our past, parts of our lives, parts of who we are because they're too painful. Something about it is embarrassing. It's too 20th century. It's not who I want to be now. And then again, sometimes we can't let go of some part of our past. And it becomes too defining, too distracting, too restricting, perhaps even suffocating. And then we can't move forward. We can't be that new thing that God is calling us to be. More and more to me, it seems that that enlightenment requires the capacity to hold two contradictory thoughts at the same time, in the same place. So the question is, how do we hold on to the past in a way that makes us wiser and helps us understand our place in the long arc of the human story? And at the same time, be here now, fully in the present, and open to what new thing might come. How do we hold eternity and our mortality in the same hand? Some of us, as we move forward in life, will feel more liberated to embrace new things, and some of us will feel more bound by what's gone before. And it can be really scary and challenging to try a new thing, to become a new thing. But be not afraid. In this reading from Isaiah, God reassures the Jews in Babylon that they'll be okay if they try this new thing. In the first few lines, God does recall the former things. I made a path in the mighty waters. Who brings out the chariot and horse, army and warrior? They lie down, they cannot rise. God's recalling leading the Jews out of Egypt and out of slavery and bondage. God's recalling the parting of the Red Sea, the escape of the Israelites, the closing of the Red Sea, wiping out the Pharaoh's chariots. Do not remember the old things or consider do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I'm about to do a new thing. About to do a new thing. This is where we're entering into the story too, where the Christian tradition is about to do a new thing. Now, the waters are going to spring forth. Do you not perceive it? That's what Isaiah says, what God says. Do you not perceive it? How many times do we miss the new thing because our vision is focused on the old thing? Because we're looking backward instead of forward. God says, I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. See, that long trek, that's a long trek from Babylon back to Israel. And it's a dangerous trek. It's a dangerous trek through wilderness, through deserts. But just as years before, the water quenched their oppressors as they pass through the Red Sea from slavery to freedom. Water now will flow and lead them through the desert, sustaining them through the change, and will even tame the wild animals, which would have been a threat to the travelers. Even the wild animals will honor God. If God had not wanted us to change, God would have made us out of stone instead of bone. If God had not wanted us to change, God would have put something hard in our head, something iron couldn't even grind, instead of the neuroplasticity of the human mind. If God had wanted us to be locked in a mindset 2,000 years old or 3,000 years old, there would have been no need for time, no need for the setting of the sun or the rising of the moon. For one day would be the next, like the next, and there would be no need. Life itself is change. God is a creative act. Our challenge is to remember the former things without being senselessly bound or dragged down, and at the same moment be open to the new things that God is doing with us and in us. So in this time of Lent, as we draw nearer to that day of Easter, perhaps we can take some of this time to look inside and to reflect. What am I clinging to? What am I clinging to? What am I holding on to that I can't let go? What is keeping me from the new thing God is trying to do, trying to call me in my life? Beloved God, creator of all that is seen and unseen, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, we are so challenged in our human form at times. We have become at times enslaved by the clock. We have become enslaved by experiences or ideas that were precious to us a long time ago. While ago, they might not fit us anymore, and we can't seem to let go of them sometimes. See what you're calling us to now. So we pray, God, as we take the next couple weeks to remember and to reflect, to recommit ourselves to your call. Help us see what we need to let go of. Help us to loosen our grip. Help us to open our arms to this new thing. I want to invite everybody on Zoom. We're moving into communion, so if you don't have your elements, I would like to encourage you to get them. And I want to tell you, we're going to do a couple things today. I just want to give you a little precursor. The invitation to the table, I'm going to say a few words, but Kristen is going to read a poem to really welcome us and bring us into the spirit of communion. And Allie is going to pray the prayers of the community, as she does for us, and she's going to ask for prayers from anybody in the sanctuary who might want to offer them aloud. And when we say the Lord's, we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. Everyone is invited to join in. And afterwards, Mike Denny is going to give us a musical meditation of the song, the Lord's Prayer. I just want to give you a little idea of where we're going. I'm going to move up here and there. We always begin at the table with the invitation. And for me, the invitation is to remind everyone here that this table does not belong to the Sausalito Presbyterian Church, and it doesn't belong to the Presbyterian Church USA, and really it doesn't belong to Christians. There were no Christians when this first dinner was had, the dinner we remember. this is God's table. And God calls us, just as you are, to come here in communion, to be connected to God and to our friends on earth and our friends above, our friends here in Sausalito and our unknown, unnamed friends in Ukraine, and Tigray, and Russia, and South America. And so, Kristen, will you help bring us into this moment?
Hide and Seek by Malcolm Gite. Ready or not, you tell me, here I come. And so I know I'm hiding, and I know my hiding place is useless. You will come and find me. You are searching high and low. Today I'm hiding low, down here below the sunlit surface others see. Oh, find me quickly, quickly come to me. And here you come, and here I come to you. I come to you because you come to me. You know my hiding places. I know you. I reach you through your hiding places too. Touching the slender thread, but now I see, even in darkness, I can see you shine, risen in bread and reveling in wine.
Will you please pray? Beloved God, we give thanks for this time together and for this moment of prayer, when we can open our hearts with words, awkward or however they come to us, names, ideas, and just lift them up to you, for you are always listening. And we lift up now, Allie lifts up now, the prayers of the people from the congregation.
We have a welcome home for Larry. And continued, and continued recovery. Thanks for Martha's recovery. Continued healing for Melanie. We pray for Rain in California. We pray for Louise and a successful surgery and a speedy recovery. Prayer for Tom Beckett and his family. Prayers for peace in Ukraine. Continued prayer for the miracle of healing and reconciliation and for a miracle realized. We ask for comfort for the Hockenstadt family and all those who mourn. Some names: James, Kay, Keith, John, Steve, Casper. Is there anyone who'd like to say, call out a prayer to this morning? No?
Carter Nestel, whose grandmother was very, was remembered on Friday in memorial, and that's Lisa Nichols' mom.
Okay. Thank you, God, for hearing these prayers. We ask for a special touch for anyone who needs it this morning.
God, we give you thanks for hearing us from our hearts when we don't have the words and we don't know what prayer is or how to say it. So hear us as we all take time to sit silently in prayer and thought, read our hearts, know our minds. We pray for your comfort, for your ear. O Lord, hear our prayers and hear us as we pray the words that Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debts. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus sat with his close friends gathered around him, a motley crew, a flawed group, each and every one of them, loved, embraced. He called them friend. And he took bread and he gave thanks to God, blessing it. And he broke that bread and he gave it to his friends, saying, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. And after the supper, he took the wine and he poured a cup. And he blessed it, giving thanks to God, and then shared it with his friends, saying, Take, drink. This is the cup of the new covenant. Now, do these things in remembrance of me. So we come now to the table to share this bread and this cup, to dwell in the presence of God and with each other. The red cup is wine, the other cup, the light cup, is grape juice. I'll just invite people just to come up. At home.
My shepherd,
He breathes my own breath.
Please pray with me. Beloved God, we pray that long after this morsel of bread and this drop of wine leaves our lips, that your love will still burn deeply in our hearts, that our ability to keep it to ourselves will completely weaken, and we will be just inspired and emboldened to share that love wildly and widely wherever we go. In your holy name we pray. Amen. There is a collection plate in the back of the church for those in the sanctuary if you want to make an offering on your way out. For those of you on Zoom, if you have Givelify, thank you so much for using that. We appreciate everyone who sends in offerings and for your generosity and for enabling us to continue the ministry that we have. Beloved God, we give thanks for all the good gifts you've given us and pray for the wisdom to use them wisely. Amen. On Thursday, April 14th at 6 p.m., we'll be having the Maundy Thursday service. And if, you know, I just want to go ahead and encourage you, if you're kind of like, well, I don't really know what that's going to be, come and check it out. Nobody's ever asked for a refund. It's a joke. It doesn't cost anything. It's just a really sweet evening, and we'll figure out how we're going to Zoomify this event. But it's a sweet evening. It's not like worship, which can also be sweet. But if you haven't been, I encourage you to give it a try. The other thing, I just want to take a little poll, because over the last couple of days, I've been sampling resurrection moments from, you know, seminal films like The Greatest Story Ever Told and Jesus of Nazareth, the Franco Zeffirelli, if you know that version, Jesus Christ Superstar, Godspell. And I had this idea, if anyone would be interested, on Holy Week to do like a little Zoom gathering where I would show a little clip and talk about just sort of how the theology is being presented, how it differs from the, you know, from the book and also from other films. I don't know, is that anything you would be interested in? If not, that's okay, my feelings aren't hurt. Yes, a couple of nods, okay. All right, if there's a small crowd, that's good. Okay, choir and Nancy, Brenda. So good, so I'll figure out the timing for all of that. It's so good to spend this time together to share our hearts and our minds and our prayers and our joys, our sorrows and our friendship and fellowship. So if you're online, I encourage you to drop in on a friendship room. And if you're here in the sanctuary, I encourage you to come downstairs to the patio and enjoy some snacks and some camaraderie. And then it's choir. Let us go out into the world remembering and letting go and embracing that new thing that's happening, remembering always that life is short and we haven't much time to gladden the hearts of those who journey the way with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind. Remember always that the love of God and the grace of our brother Christ and the sustaining breath of the Holy Spirit is with us now and forevermore. Wherever you go, may you go in peace. Let the people say.
Amen.
Amen.